Talk a lot.
One more second?
Go ahead.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. إن شاء الله this lecture will be mostly in English because this topic is mostly pertaining to brothers and sisters and youngsters who deal with this society. And it's very obvious that a month ago, all the stores, all the department stores, everywhere you go, it's like a bombardment with Christmas music, with Christmas-themed decorations. And a couple of weeks, two, 3 weeks before Christmas, we started with ornaments and decorations and extreme waste and electricity and money. So it's important for us as living in this society to be aware of what this occasion is about. And one purpose is to try to engage other people with the fruitful discussion. And the other purpose is also, as we see at the end, inshallah ta'ala, to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing on Islam. Because our Islam is very pure, very simple, and it's very continuous. From the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam until this very moment, Islam is very clear and very obvious for those who are open-minded. Compared to what we're going to see today, where things have been in the flux and things have evolved over the last 2,000 years. So we'll talk, inshallah ta'ala, about the Christian holidays from a Muslim perspective. Christmas, because that is the most important occasion from a Western perspective. What is the supposed occasion of Christmas? You can ask anyone, it's supposed to be the birth of Jesus. And in fact, you see many signs on the street, happy birthday Jesus, because that's what the commoners know and that's what the commoners think. What are the color symbols? Forget about this slide. Don't look at this slide. And just mention in your mind, you probably looked at it, so you cheated a little bit. But especially the youngsters, when you say Christmas, what comes to your mind?
Christ.
Well, not to the average person, but I can. What else?
Business.
Businesses. Symbols, other symbols. Youngsters, don't be afraid.
Gifts.
What else?
Trees.
Christmas trees. What else? The famous figure.
Snow.
Santa Claus. Saint Nicholas. So all these are supposed to be symbols of Christmas. But as we'll see, inshallah ta'ala, every single one of these symbols have nothing to do with Christianity and nothing to do with Christmas. So these are again some of the symbols that we talk about, inshallah ta'ala. Santa Claus, Christmas trees, lights, gifts, carols. That's what occurs to the average mind when we talk about Christmas. What is the origin of the word? You can understand many things from learning about the origin of the word. The origin of the word Christmas comes from two words, from Chris or Christ and from Mass. Chris, obviously, is from the Latin Christos. The Christianity is very heavy in Latin language. Many of the Christian terminology is derived from Latin because that's where it originally spread. So the word Christos from Latin comes from original Greek Christos, and it's nothing but anointed. And it comes from the original Hebrew Mashiach, which is in Arabic al-Masih, Yeshua al-Masih. We all know Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam as Yeshua al-Masih. So it's an interesting point here, because many Christians, when they start debating about Islam, do you believe in Christ as a Messiah? That's the first step, they want to fight for it. And if you don't believe in that, you're not Muslims by definition. Islam tells us that Isa is al-Masih. The only problem is, when they say is Isa the Messiah, what they mean by Messiah has the divine attribute. But the word Messiah in itself means nothing but anointed, which means blessed. So we obviously believe that Messiah is a blessed person. Of all the people to be blessed, Prophet Isa alayhi salam is one of the most blessed people. He was one of the five ulil azm min al-rusul. So again, it's important to define your terminology when somebody comes to you, dashing at you, asking you, is you believe in Jesus as the Messiah. Yeah, we believe in the Messiah, but you have to tell them, define what Messiah is, because for you and for me, it may be something different. And Mass comes from celebration, Mass or celebration. So that's the origin of the word. History, don't worry about all this fine typographical errors, just for those who can figure it out. I'll go over them, inshallah ta'ala, one line at a time briefly. What is the year of the birth of Jesus? You would think that the year of birth is zero or one. Now, it cannot be zero. Why cannot it be zero? Anybody who knows why it cannot be zero? When was the zero known? But the zero was known, was promoted by the Arabs, by the Muslims, 600 years later, 700 years later. So most often they started their dates from the year one. So we think that maybe the year one is the year of birth of Jesus. But according to the own biblical scholars, they don't know. The most scholars say, well, maybe Jesus was born 4 BC. BC is before Christ. So Christ was born 4 before Christ. It sounds strange. And they show you the star of Bethlehem and so on. Again, there is so many disputes about whether the star of Bethlehem is. Is it a conjunction of two planets? Is it the star? Is it whatever? But again, just something for popular consumption to make people just love this occasion and give it a metaphysical, spiritual occasion. But if you look at their own biblical work, nobody knows exactly when Jesus was born. And the Holy Quran, what was the season of the birth of Jesus? The Quran tells us in Surah Maryam, وَهُزِّي إِلَيْكِ بِجِدْعِي
النَّخْلَةِ.
So Allah could have made it a miracle. It could not have been the season of the palm tree, but most likely it was a season where the palm days are ripe, so it would be probably somewhere in spring. It's not in middle December, in late December, in the middle of winter. It's probably in spring, Allahu A'lam, according to the Quran, although we're not sure about that. But in the Christian version, the commonly promoted version, the birth of Jesus is at the end of December. But even if you look at the Bible itself, the Bible has no mention that the birth of Jesus was in the middle of winter. In fact, the only mention of the birth of Jesus in the New Testament is in Luke, and it says that the shepherds were grazing their sheep outside at night when the angels allegedly came to them and told them about the birth of Jesus. And many of us are from Palestine. In the middle of winter, the sheep don't graze outside. They are kept in the corral, in a havira, or indoor in some protected place. They're not going, because there is not a whole lot of food for them to go and graze. So even according to the Bible, the time of the birth of Jesus is not winter. Most likely, it's probably somewhere in spring. The other point that's related to this is that until the 3rd century plus, Christians did not celebrate the birthday of Jesus. For them, it was not the reason for celebration. In fact, looking at the old literature in the Catholic Encyclopedia, in the scriptures, no one is recorded to have kept a feast or held a great banquet on his birthday. It is only sinners like Pharaoh and Herod who make great rejoicing over the day, over the clay in which they were born into this world. So they were born of clay material. On that day they are born. Only sinners in the old times used to celebrate that day and make it into festivities. The religious people at the time of the prophets, the prophet of the Old Testament, the prophet of the New Testament, they did not used to make any particular day of the birth of any important person or of the prophets. In the Encyclopedia Americana, again, dating from 1944, a feast was established in memory of this event, Christ's birth, in the 4th century. So it took three and a half centuries to start the celebration of Christmas. And the Western Church ordered it to be celebrated on the day of the old Roman feast of the birth of Sol. If you know French, you know that the Sol from Soleil means the sun. So obviously before Christianity spread into Rome and into Greek and into the northern, into Europe, they were pagans, they were idol worshippers. Many of them worshiped the sun, and they had special celebration of the sun. They called it Sol. So that celebration happened, most of them, in late December. They did not have accurate calendar, so they did not know about the winter solstice. Right now, if you recognize, this is today the first full day of winter. What was yesterday, 10:40 p.m. or so? It was the exact time of the winter solstice. What is the winter solstice?
Longest night.
What's that?
Longest night.
The shortest day, the longest night. So if you can visualize the globe of the Earth, we have the equator, and we have above it the Tropic of Capricorn, and below it the other tropic, and then the sun, the perpendicular rays of the sun, goes from the equator, goes further up north, and when it's further up north, what season would that be in the northern hemisphere? It would be summer. because that the sun is shining directly on the northern hemisphere, and when it moves to the middle, then it becomes autumn, and then it moves further down, it is the winter, and then it moves back, and it is the spring. So depending on the angle of the sun, you can have different variety of the season. That's a sign from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it was not for this angle of the earth, there would not be four seasons, and we would not have vegetation. But these four different phases are called winter solstice, when the sun is at its steepest point further south, and the summer solstice, when the sun is all the way up, and the spring and the autumn equinoxes, when the days are equal in the half in the northern and southern hemisphere. So in the winter solstice, the day is the shortest and the night is the longest. You can visualize that people who used to worship the sun and used to rely very heavily on the sun for their vegetation, for their planting, for their livestock, for their life in general, when the days got shorter, they were afraid that the god of darkness is going to be defeated by the god of light is going to be defeated by the god of darkness. So they had multiple celebrations to celebrate these occasions and to try to make prayers and offering for the god of light so that it will defeat the god of darkness. And they have different versions depending on what locations in Europe, whether it's in Greek or Rome or Germanic people in Northern Europe. So that is the day of the celebration of the winter solstice that later the church, according to what we see here in this slide, the church decreed that this day should be used as the birthday of Christ. What is this December 25th? Again, one of the major so-called gods that they used to worship is called Mithra. It is also a god, according to them, that is a descendant from the sun god, from the sun as in the star, the sun, the star. And it was intermediary between the sun and between the people, between the human beings. And that winter solstice is December 25 is the time of these celebrations of the birthday of that pagan god Mithra. Again, they did not have accurate calendars for them to be close. December 21st is the actual winter solstice. They were celebrating in December 25th because they did not have accurate calendars, but it's still close enough. And that is the occasion for the celebration of this time. One quick exercise, if you want to convince yourself that during the winter solstice, the day is the shortest, just measure the length of the day. The day for us Muslims starts from Fajr until Isha. But technically, astronomically, the day starts accurately from sunrise and it ends exactly at sunset. So if you go to a Muslim calendar and you then measure the difference between sunrise and between sunset, you get the actual length of the day. And if you do your calculations for several days or for a few weeks, you realize that during that period of time, plus or minus, that will be the shortest day of the year. So again, this was the reason of celebration of this occasion. This pagan festival was present in old Egypt, is present in old Europe. And again, as I mentioned, the people who worship the sun used to be afraid that it's going to be defeated, so they have these celebrations. And by celebrations, we're not talking just about prayer and charity like we do. By celebrations, they had wine and dancing and parties and so on and so forth. And this is what has been transmitted all the way to Christianity. Okay, so if you want to know more about this religion that was moved, the celebration of which was moved into Christianity, you can go and check about Mithraism. It is one of the major religions of the Roman Empire. They adopted it from the Persians. Again, every single culture at the time used to have their own versions of so-called gods in Egypt, in Persia, and Rome, and they used to adopt each other's gods, especially when they went and conquered people. They went and adopted some of their cultures and some of their religion. Interestingly, Mithraism has many things that are still in common with common Christianity. If you look, for example, at the common points, the ideas of humility, of brotherly love, of baptism, which is a key point in Christianity, especially for Baptists, the rite of the communion, holy water, the adoration of the shepherds at Mithra's birth, like what we see in TV during the shepherds bringing some gifts to the baby Jesus in the manger, and all the way, immortality of the soul. It differed, the Mithraism differed slightly from Christianity in excluding women and its willingness to compromise with polytheism. Although apparently Christianity did not want to compromise with polytheism, but they still adapted many of their cultures. But again, subhanAllah, that's where it has to do with the origin of the Christianity. How did the Christianity move away from the teachings of Prophet Jesus, alayhi salam? This is one very good explanation. in order for the original church to spread its teachings to Europe and to try to incorporate as many followers as possible, they did not mind distorting their ideas a little bit, distorting their theology a little bit, especially accepting the festivities, the Eid of the other cultures, and then slowly and gradually they adopted them. As some scholars said, instead of Rome becoming Christian, Christianity became Roman. So the Christianity, the church, the popes at the time, tried to adopt it slowly, the cultures of the countries in which they spread, so that they can accommodate them as much as possible. So at any expense. Alhamdulillah, thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing of Islam. Islam is there, Islam is here. Whoever wants to accept it is there. You don't like it? That's subhanAllah. That's your own choice. You go by choice. But we don't distort Islam. We don't start to make a tweak, especially the aqidah, the creed of Islam, to accommodate as many people as possible, unlike what other cultures have done. Okay, going now to the major figures of this Christmas celebration. One of the most major figures is Santa Claus. In fact, he overshadows Jesus. When you ask any child about Christmas, now, it's not the first name that occurs to their mind. The first name that comes to their mind is Santa Claus. So who is Santa Claus? Again, Santa Claus has numerous names. It has Saint Nicholas, it has the name of Saint Nick, Kris Kringles, among other names. If you look at the sequence of the letters, some Muslim scholars said Santa is nothing but the distortion of Satan. You just change one word and it becomes Satan, and subhanAllah, it's to many extent it is true. So who was Santa Claus or Saint Nick? He's supposed to be a 4th century bishop saint. One of the stories around his origin is that there were some daughters, some girls, and their father wanted to give them to be prostitutes, what I read about some other people. So he went and he paid their dowry to save them from this dire predicament. Something that any person, I'm sure every single person in this room, if he was faced with that situation, he would not hesitate to pay from their own money or collect and save any girl, whether it's Muslim or non-Muslim, from this bad situation. But in this instance, this person was made into a saint, and his sainthood came way, way later. But this is the figure around which the mythology started. If we look again, as we mentioned, there are many, many similarities between Christianity and between pre-Christian pagan holidays. Now let's look at the old pagan holidays and see what figure is similar to Santa Claus. One of the main figures is Saturn, and I'll show you a slide in a minute, inshallah ta'ala. It's most likely, many scholars say, it is an adaptation of Saturn, the Roman god of time. Saturn, you know, it's the name of a planet, but it's also the name of a Roman god. One of the famous medieval painters, Raphael, if you remember, he has the picture of the creation, right, in the dome of the cathedral, where God stretching his hand to meet the god of Adam, something beyond disbelief, beyond shirk. But this famous painter has also a picture of Saturn. Has a picture of Saturn, and this picture of Saturn is very similar in many aspects to Santa Claus. And again, Santa Claus was chosen to go down the chimney rather than the door, similar to an old, again, pagan god, Hertha, who was the goddess of fire. So to show you some of these slides, this is the picture of nowadays modern Santa Claus. He rides in a sleigh, and he is drawn by reindeer. This is a picture of Saturn based on Raphael. It's an old man with white beard, sitting in a chariot. It's not a sleigh, it's a chariot, but very similar. And it's drawn by an animal that normally cannot fly. In this instance, it's a dragon or a serpent. In this instance, it's reindeer. But the similarities are very obvious. A mythical figure that has mythical powers, that can go in one night everywhere on Earth, and can visit every single household and every single child, and he knows who's good and who's bad, and they can give them gifts if they're good in one single night. So, subhanAllah, these attributes that are divine, that are holy, it is not befitting for any person, but this is what the mythology is about.
This is for
Lees,
right?
Excuse me?
That was for Lees, right?
That is what?
For Lees,
yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so, again, you can just Google that. Okay, more, how did the story of Santa Claus evolve? Again, you can look at the terminology. In 1809, a certain novelist started with the idea of Santa Claus. He adopted it from a Dutch figure.
adopted as a white bearded flying horse riding Saint Nicholas with the Dutch name Santa Claus. And then now the Dutch name started getting more popular. That was the first step. And then a professor at the seminary union later made the poem, the famous poem that people sing nowadays, it was the light before Christmas and not a soul was there, not even a mouse. And in that, and in that poet, he started adding stuff to Santa. He made, he gave him 8 reindeer who drag him in the sky and then he descends through the chimney. Another illustrator, a very illustrator later, completed the myth of Santa Claus by giving him a house in the North Pole. You know, that's what kids think. In fact, they mail him letters. That's one very busy season because kids mail letters to Santa Claus. And he has a list of the good and bad children of the world. And then in the finest role, nothing else but the Coca-Cola company. It, since they started, they have this red symbol. Their Coke can is red. So they paint a certain painter. His name is what? Sunblom. To make a Santa Claus as wearing red clothes, the exact color of the Coke can. So it came through evolution all the way to come the colored version of Santa Claus. The big, fat, white bearded guy who flies through the sky with a reindeer and who knows the good and the bad children and who can give them gifts. So it's, this is again what in one website says, it's not my word. Santa Claus was born, a blend of Christian crusader, pagan god, and commercial idol. It's a combination of different elements all together. So again, subhanAllah, you see how the shaitan lays tricks on the minds of people and plays it in a very, very slow, very progressive manner. It does not bring this figure just right up front and that's it. Go and respect him. It's a very slow, gradual, evolving process. Look, again, these are subtle things that you don't pay attention to, but it's all built into the psyche of the people. As you, some of you know, he has 8 reindeer, and look at the name of the deer. Even the name of the deer is something that's not decent, not moral. The first one, the most famous one, is Rudolph, the red-nosed deer. Red is always the color of passion, and when the nose is red, that's a sign that this reindeer is drunk or is full of passion or something. That is not a good symbol to give to any person. Look at the other Santa Claus reindeer, Cupid. We all know Cupid. You see it in St. Valentine with an arrow going out at the people's heart. Again, it's the name of a Roman god of love, most often improper love. Transient means sublime peace with oneself. There's something against the idea of humility that even Christianity holds. And Vixen means an ill-tempered woman. Look at these, the names alone don't make sense, but subhanAllah, the power of commercialization is stronger than logic in the mind of people. They follow blindly to the idea, they stop analyzing what they see, they take it just as for granted. Okay, does any brothers, any of the brothers have some comments or some addition about Santa Claus while I rest my vocal cords for a few seconds? Anything, Chef? Any comments since you came to America?
Well, the initial images of Santa Claus, he used to come with the devil. The devil used to come with, actually yesterday there was a program about the History Channel. The devil with a red tongue, and you know, like, so he will give gifts for the good kids, and he will punish the bad kids.
One other thing, again, we have to try the parallelism to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the blessing of this time. Many of your Christmas holidays teach some negative thing to the children. The theme behind Christmas is lying. The parents go to the store, they spend hours and hours, they go and buy the gifts, and then they come and wrap it, they put it under a so-called tree, and when the kids wake up, they tell them that Santa Claus, a mythical figure, bought their gifts. And then kids grow until they start getting smart, and they start realizing, no, that's not true, it must be somebody else. But how come from the little age of the kids, you let them grow up with lying and with confusion about biblical figures? It is very wrong. We're not going to talk much about it, but look at the other celebrations, for example. When it comes to Halloween, what is the famous statement for Halloween? Trick or treat. What does it mean, trick or treat? You either give me candy or I'll trick you. I'll hurt your house. I'll toilet paper your trees or I'll scratch on your doors or something. So what is the theme over there? Begging, you teach people how to go and beg for candy. They're rich, why do you go and beg? Buy the candy at Walmart, it's on sale. Or vandalism, if you don't treat me well, I will vandalize your house and so on. So the kids are taught lying, the kids are taught vandalism, and don't belittle these little things. They go into the building of the psyche, of the morality of the kids. Well, inshallah, let's move to the next famous figure. When you say Christmas, the first thing that comes to your mind is also the second thing is Christmas trees. Another name for it is Yule trees. I did some research, you can Google it. The number of Christmas trees sell only in USA, about 40 million trees. And if you do the average of how much it costs per tree, the total US sale of Christmas trees is $2.4 billion. The budget of probably a country in Africa that could feed hungry people in Africa and maybe in America for decades just for Christmas trees that a couple days later becomes trash or becomes landfill, or just to make them feel better, they go and take them to the shore to build up the hurricane defense system so they can expand our shores. But it's a complete waste of money. What is again the origin of Christmas trees? It has nothing to do with Christianity. The origin is, initially it was from Egypt, because if you look at it, it's nothing but a pyramid. The pyramid is a geometrical shape connected by a dot from the top. It could be a triangle, it could be a rectangle, it could be a circle, but it still is a pyramidal shape. The Egypt has value for the pyramids, and the Christmas tree also is a pointed tree that has some religious value for them, and that's something that was adopted by the Romans and the Greeks. The important value for them, for the Christmas tree, is an evergreen tree. So remember about when we talked about the winter, and during the winter the sun is, the days are getting shorter and the nights are getting longer, so people are afraid. But this tree is an evergreen tree. Summer, spring, autumn, whatever, it stays green. So it is a symbol of that the god of light is always defeating the god of darkness. It is not affected by the cold weather of winter. So that thus it was used as a symbol for this occasion. At the very tip also, they always have a source of light. They have a star at the tip of the tree. Some people think it's the Star of Bethlehem. It has nothing to do with it. It's pre-Christian. Again, it's the stars that used to be worshipped by the Romans, including Apollo, the sun god. So again, all these Christmas trees are nothing but old pagan ritual. That's from history. Even if you look at the Old Testament or at the Bible of the Christians and the Jews, in their own Bible, it condemns the habit of getting trees and calls it as the way of the heathen. Heathen means the other worshippers. And if you just read these verses from Jeremiah chapter 10, verses 1 and 5, in the King James Version, the other versions are very similar. It says, "Thus says the Lord, they are not the way of the heathen, and be not dismayed at the signs of heaven, for the heathen are dismayed by them." So what is going to follow is what the heathen do, the idol worshippers. What do? The customs of the people are vain. For one cutteth a tree out of the forest, the work of the hands of the workmen of the axe. They deck it with silver and with gold. They fasten it with nails and with hammers, that it move not. Other than the artificial trees that are now common, this is a very clear description of the Christmas tree. People go to the forest, they chop the tree with an axe, they fix it with nails so it stands upright, and they deck it with silver and with gold. This is as clear of a description of Christmas tree as you can find anywhere. And the Bible, the own Bible said, it is upright that the palm trees speak not. They must need be warned. They don't help themselves. They cannot go. Be not afraid for them, for they cannot do evil, neither also it is for them to do good. These trees cannot harm themselves, cannot harm others, cannot benefit themselves, or cannot benefit others. These are the ways of the heathen, the idol worshippers. So this is what the Bible says, and yet every single house in America has to have a tree. They feel pessimistic. If they don't have a tree, something wrong is going to happen. But the Bible says, do not be afraid of them. Again, the power of commercialization, the power of deviation from the original teachings of Christianity. Okay, and again, if you're interested, to quote it, it's Jeremiah chapter 10, verses 1 to 5. But if anybody needs the presentation, I can email it to them, inshallah. Okay, what is the other custom? Gifts? Again, gifts are very noble, very good. It's very generous to give gifts, but even gifts had pre-Christian pagan customs. The Romans used to kill people, and then later they stopped killing people. They started just putting toys to symbolize people instead of human sacrifice. And later that custom was adopted by the Christians when they took over the Roman Empire. So again, even the origin of gifts is pre-Christian, and it has some bad connotations. Nowadays, gifts It's nice, it stimulates the economy, but again, more often than not, it's not because of generosity, it's done because of expectations. People expect to have gifts in Christmas. The kids expect to have things in Christmas, so the stores are obliged, and they bombard people with sales and with music, and people go and buy gifts, and then later they become trash. So again, the power of commercialization, like we saw with Santa Claus, and like we saw with the Christmas trees. And what is the other custom? Many of you are familiar. Obviously, many of us, if not most of us, watch movies. The custom of the mistletoe. They feel like if somebody, if a pair, man and a woman, or a girl and a boy, are under mistletoe, then it is bad luck not to kiss. SubhanAllah. It's the custom itself is so much against not just Islam, against just morality, against common sense, against even the religious values of Christianity. Again, SubhanAllah, it's not the time for it, but it is said in the New Testament. Jesus, peace upon him, said in the New Testament, again, I don't have the authenticity, but he said, the Old Testament told you not to commit adultery. I told you, don't let your eye commit adultery. It's better for you to block your eye out rather than let your look at haram things. So the same concept of what the Muslim in Islam taken to an extreme because it was done in the Jewish population. But look at that teachings of Prophet Jesus and the teachings of mistletoe, where if a couple happens to be under a mistletoe, some special stand, they have to kiss. And again, this custom is pre-Christian. It comes from the old Germanic people. Again, if a girl falls under a mistletoe and is not kissed, then she would not be married in the next year, according to their customs and to their mythology. Again, what they say again from this website, whether we believe it or not, it always makes for fun and frolic at Christmas celebrations. So why did they do it? Because it's fun. That is the justification for doing these things. And I'll have a slide at the end, inshallah ta'ala, to talk about this concept of fun. Even if the pagan significance has been long forgotten, the custom of exchanging a kiss under the mistletoe can still be found in many European countries as well as in Canada. Again, another victory for the shaytan, taking some old pre-Christian immoral customs and incorporating them into a so-called Christmas religious celebrations. Okay, inshallah, I think there are lots of things to talk about Christmas, and again, I'm not a scholar of Christianity or of Christmas, but this is just some research that I've done throughout the years. But while we have the occasion, inshallah ta'ala, while we have a captive audience, we can also mention quickly, maybe a couple slides on each, about some other Christian celebrations, including the Easter. Now, Christmas is supposed to be, allegedly, as you know, the birth of Jesus. It is all wrong, but that's what people think. But what is the more important religious occasion, that is the alleged death of Jesus. For us, he did not die, he was elevated to the sky, but for them, he died to take up the sins of humans, and then he defeated death, and he rose up again. So this season of Easter has way more important religious connotation than the birth of Jesus. Look at Easter. Even Easter has nothing to do originally with Christianity. Okay, supposed occasion, feast that commemorates Christ's death and ultimate resurrection. It happens on Easter Monday. And Easter Monday, subhanAllah, again, you might wonder, why does Mardi Gras fall on different time of the year? And that is the reason, because Mardi Gras is connected to Easter Sunday. And Easter Sunday, the definition of Easter Sunday, as you see, in 2013, it was 31st. 2014, April 20. 2015, April 5, and so on and so forth. Because Easter Sunday should fall on the first full moon that occurs on or just or after the spring equinox. And the spring equinox is the first day of spring, which should be March 21st. So the first full moon after the beginning of spring is Easter Sunday, and you take 46 days before that, and you get Ash Wednesday, and take a day before, and you become to Fat Tuesday or Mardi Gras. So it is a very strange connection between the lunar calendar and the solar calendar. That's why it varies from one year to a year. But what are the, as much as we saw the symbols of Christianity, of Christmas, Santa Claus, Christmas trees, gifts, ornaments, mistletoe, what are the symptoms of Easter? We all know them. When you go to Walmart, they're all over the aisles. Eggs, chocolate eggs or colored eggs, and bunny rabbits, and Easter parades, Macy's parades and stuff. Again, what is the origin of the word? You might think that Easter comes from east, where the sun rises, but it has nothing to do with the east. The origin comes from a name, again, of a pre-Christian Germanic goddess called Austron, Later, it turned English into Easter. So even the word Easter, and again, these are not my words. You go to the word origin, and you can find this. This is the name of an old Germanic goddess. So why this Christian, this goddess turned into a Christian celebration? Again, goes to the same principle. The church wanted to incorporate as many people as possible. So instead of trying to convince them and talk to them about the benefit of this religion, they try to adopt as many customs as possible. And this one of them, the spring festival. This is the time where the nature revives, the nature is born again, and so on. So it was a pre-Christian celebration, and the Christians adopted it. And the symbols relate to this budding and this new life. Eggs, even in pagan history, they are a symbol of sex, of reproduction, and of fertility. So they are adopted in this occasion. Rabbits, again, they are some of the most fertile animals. You leave two rabbits on an island, and within a couple of decades, it fills up with rabbits. And Easter parades, again, it imitates the nature. It emerges in their own gorgeous new attire of delicate green. And that's why people go and buy new clothes in Easter. So in conclusion, again, even Easter is a pagan festival for celebrating Easter, the spring goddess. So the major Christian holidays, Christmas, supposed to be the birth of Christ, and Easter, supposed to be the death and the resurrection, alleged resurrection and death of Jesus, again, they have nothing to do with Christianity, it's all pagan customs. So alhamdulillah, rahmat al-Islam. Okay. Again, just to show you how much this, we don't appreciate that very much, we take it for granted, but the pre-Christian Roman and Greek culture is very much intertwined into the Western culture in America and Europe. Look at the names for the month. Again, many of you know them, but just to list them all, we'll talk about how the pre-Christian Greek and Romans affected Christianity. The names of the month are nothing but names of Greek and Roman gods and so on. January is the name of Janus, the Roman god who has head with two faces, one looking in opposite direction. It's the name of an investment company. If you look online, Janus has symbol as a person with two heads. This was the name of the god, and this is the name they opted for the first month of the year. February, again, is the name of Februarius, an old festival of purification. Mars after the Mars, the famous god of war of the Romans. April after Aphrodite, the goddess of love. May after Maya, the Roman goddess. And June after Juno. July, it's after Julius Caesar. Julius Caesar names the month after him, and this month, this name stuck with him forever. Now, August is again the name of the Roman Emperor Augustus, so you can hear the similarity in the names. Now, September, October, November, and December are supposed to be 9, 10, 11, and 12 months of the year. But September and October, how many sides does the octagon have?
7.5.
Round up, how many? 8. So October, from October means 8, it's supposed to be the 8th month. But what month is October?
10.
It's the 10th month. Why is that? Because something changed. The old Roman calendar began with March, so as such, September was 7, 8, 9, 10. But after it changed it, some emperor changed it later, it becomes 8, 9, 10, 7, 8, 9, 10 became shifted up to. But initially, they were the name of the 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th months of the Roman calendar. So all the Christian calendars that use right now, or at least the vast majority, is the name of Roman gods, Greek gods, and Roman emperors. So you think that when Christianity came, well, at least they should change the months and give it some important holy names. But no, subhanAllah, they kept the pre-Christian Roman gods. The same thing applies for the days. But let's see, Monday, what day would you think it is? Monday, the day of what? Remember, they worship gods and they worship planets. So what's Monday, you think? What is the closest?
Moon,
the day of the moon.
Sunday,
day of the sun. As promised, Sunday is the day of the sun, the day where they made holy, they glorified, and they worship the sun. So look at the Western days of the week. Again, we put it on our calendar and we write them, we don't pay attention to them. But again, these days, look at the meanings of these days. Sunday is the day of the sun, Monday moon, Tuesday day of Tiu, Germanic god, Wednesday day of Odin or Odin. Who has seen the movie Thor? That guy has this day named after him. How about Thor, the one who has two through movies? Again, a Roman god, Thursday is named after Thor. So it's nice, it's fun, it's entertainment, but this is the pre-Christian Roman gods, and you know what Roman gods were. They used to be glorified and worshipped. And Friday and Saturday, the day of Saturn. So in Roman calendar, again, this is English, but it's derived from old Germanic, it could be Montag, Sundag, whatever they have, but the origin of the word stays. And interestingly enough, again, to tie Christianity with pre-Christian, what is the holy day for Christians?
Sunday.
It used to be Saturday, because that's what the Old Testament, that's Sabbath, that's the day. So why did it move to Sunday? This is one reason, because the pre-Christians used to celebrate Sunday as the day of the sun, that's the day of the worship of the sun. So the Christians came, okay, we'll take your day, we'll take some of your customs, some of your rituals, but just follow us. And Sunday became the day of the Lord in the Christian calendar, the day of the sun. Again, alhamdulillah, I'm a Christian. You see how, when you start making compromises, you end up like this. All right, what are some of the reasons for the perpetuation of these pagan rituals? First of all, the devil. The devil, obviously, the devil's the real devil, but then the human devils. The human devils can be sometimes worse than the real shaitan devil. One of the most common tricks of the shaitan is to call things by different names. Usury is haram. Riba is haram. In English, riba is usury. So what is the alternative name? Al-fa'ida, interest. It has a nice ring to the word. Modesty is very well, but what is called now art and entertainment and so on. So people now can hug and kiss and shed their clothes in the name of fun and entertainment and in the name of art. Freedom of speech is an interesting concept, but in the name of freedom of speech, they can curse the Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and they can attack others. So again, don't worry about the names, look at what it means. And the devil changed this pagan customs to have beautiful Christian names, but it's nothing but pre-Christian pagan customs. Again, these are not my words, but some scholars said, America professes to be a Christian nation, but Americans for the most part are in Babylon and don't know it. The power, the momentum, the inertia of these celebrations is too strong. Don't expect tomorrow Walmart to stand up and say, these Christian celebrations are pagans, we're not going to sell anything related to Christmas. Keep dreaming. That's not going to happen because it's a multi-billion dollar industry. As we saw, did I have it here? Yeah. All right, commercial drive. Christmas trees alone, 2.4 billion, as you saw earlier. Christmas gifts, 720 billion. $3.25 trillion. Just for gifts. This is the budget problem of the whole continent of Africa for nothing but gifts that will be trashed later. Except the Xboxes, they stay forever. At least some kids appreciate that too. Let's try. But again, it shows to the power of commercialization that trumps religion. Okay, and entertainment. Many of these things are done. When you ask people, well, we know it's wrong, but it's done for fun. In fact, when I was a doctor in North Carolina, I was discussing something with a physical therapist, and I started talking about some of these concepts that Jesus was not born in December, and he finished my sentences almost. He said, oh, well, I know he's not born in December because we think he's born in spring and so on and so forth. They teach them this for the specialists, and they know this, but the power is too much, especially the power of entertainment. The Quran tells us specifically about this. We can joke, we can have fun, as long as we don't lie, and as long as we don't touch the aqidah. There is no joking whatsoever when it comes to aqidah. Look what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us. وَذَرِ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا دِينَهُمْ لَعِبًا وَلَهْوًا وَغَرَّتْهُمُ الْحَيَاةُ الدُّنْيَا وَذَكِّرْ بِهِ أَن تُبْتَ نَفْسٌ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ لَيْسَ لَهَا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَلِيٌّ وَلَا شَفِيعٌ. So, and leave those who consider their religion as fun and entertainment, and they were deceived by the hayat al-dunya, by this worldly life. So when it comes to matter of religion, when it comes to matter of faith or of creed, there is no joking. You don't joke on about Allah, about the angels, about the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the aqidah of Islam. This is a red line when it comes to joke. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to joke and make fun, but he never lied. And he never touched anything of the thing that is sanctified. But over here, it's okay. As long as it's fun, you can distort religion, you can adopt pre-Christian pagan customs, you can do whatever you want. This is very wrong. Be very careful, especially when you think that you are making jokes or you are speaking out. And in conclusion, again, Christmas is not the birth of Jesus, but it originates in all festivals during the winter solstice, celebrating the pagan god and marking the victory of the sun god over the god of darkness. And Western and Christian practices are intertwined with pre-Christian pagan customs and practices and symbols. And as Muslims, we should not participate in them altogether. And that's where it comes to the, again, the fiqh aspect participating in these festivities is completely haram. You cannot participate with building, for example, a cave or a manger that has the figures of Christ and so on, because for them it's God. For us, he's just a human being. He's a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot be part of it at any cost. When it comes to our aqidah, there is no compromise. Now, what the scholars talked about is about celebrating them about their eyes. Many scholars, including the old the Salaf and their predecessors, they were very strict about it. For example, Ibn Taymiyyah, they said the meaning of his sentence is that you cannot even congratulate him with the Eid. Because how can you congratulate him with something haram? It's as if you saw somebody who's committing zina or who's making who's worshiping the cross, and you go and congratulate you for what he's done. Doesn't make sense. If you see something as somebody sinning or making haram, you should not congratulate him, you should stay away from it. This was the strictest version. Now, modern scholars, the Fiqh Council of Europe, some Fiqh Council in America, I think were a little bit more flexible. They said, as long as your congratulation does not contain any clear religious connotations, Merry Christmas, congratulations for the birth of your God, or something like that, if you can congratulate them in a neutral language, because of being kind, because of getting closer to their heart, closer to Islam, because you expect them to come and congratulate you and say, or Eid al-Adha, because they are your neighbors, some of them are your family, some of them are your colleagues, your friends, your partners in work. So it may be acceptable to use very neutral terms and not use cards that may contain any language that condones or supports the meaning of the religious meaning of this occasion. So again, you want to be strict, don't have anything to do with this. So you want to be flexible, you can congratulate them, but be very careful about the language that you are using.
In the office, they come and they say Merry Christmas, or they say like Happy Holidays.
And that's what I use. Happy Holidays. It's a holiday is a day off, or Happy New Year, because Happy New Year is the equivalent of saying good day, but for the whole year.
What is term we can use is season greetings.
Season's greetings.
Yeah. Season greetings.
Season greetings. Yeah.
And the other thing is season greetings.
Merry Christmas is there's any kufur means in it or
Christmas, as you mentioned, Christmas is the mass of celebration of Christ. So it's particular for them. It's a particular religious celebration. So I didn't have the chance to research that particular word, but I think it has some negative connotations. So that's best to avoid.
Every generation will have to face those challenges that everything that you brought up about Christmas, Easter, the pagan days, and also months. This is going to be an ongoing challenge for those living here in America. And being influenced is very difficult unless we stick to our deen. Then you'll find in those who graze around a sanctuary. Some will both fall in.
Yeah.
So things, unless we make sure that that generation after generation will be reminded of these difficulties and know that we're going to lose some of our...
Yeah. When we start making compromises, you don't want to end up. One of the worst things I saw is a Muslim house family with a kid sitting on the lap of Santa Claus. I could avoid that. Are we so blindly imitating the Christians like the Prophet told us?
Okay, for our youngest, the new generation, really, we all, even maybe they and we or the old generation, we never started Merry Christmas.
Yeah.
To our customers, to our neighbors, to our employees partners. But when they tell us Merry Christmas, what we should respond?
Season's greeting,
you know. Season's greeting. If you know them well, thank you, but I don't celebrate. As a Muslim, but I pray you better. But it's a long version.
It's a long version, but thank you. That's why
it's a long version. Same to you.
I guess so. Sheikh, any comments, any fiqhi aspect that you're talking about?
Jazakumullah khairan. Qult faith. Allah yukrimaka rabbul akhir. We once, so many brothers asked me about the
presentation.
Inshallah.
يعني كريديان بيبو يقول كم سيريان بيبوكين بالفرع بدلوا علينا أول ريليجن How I tell the Syrian people don't tell these people Happy Christmas
ما هي that's the point يعني the point أنه إذا بدك من باب الدعوة من باب الإنسوق من باب العلم نطلع نحن Happy Holidays Happy New Year something يعني شغل نيوتن بس ما شغل كده Merry Christmas كمان we can assert that this Merry Christmas تعطيني فيها فيها لفظة الكرايس فيها لفظة الناس معناتها فيها celebration of the birth of Jesus هذا الشيء يعني الله أعلم حساس
طالما أنا متمكن من إيماني بالله وعنيد العقيدة ربنا عالم مجرد كلمة ميري كريسمس كثرتني
لا عوز بالحد أنا حدا زي لا عوز
بالحرام يعني
غلط عم يحكي غلط كفر هذا شيء خطير جدا عوز
بالله هاي يعني انه بيهانك بيوسوها بس ان الجامل الانسان رغم انك عنيد في عقيدتك وباين في واجباتك الدينية والانسانية مش معنى كلمة حلوة تطلع
ما عندي بس الانسان بده يختار كلمة
هابي هولدي يعني بدا
هابي هولدي هابي سيزنز يعني سيزنز جريتنج يعني شغلة تكون سلبية يعني ما يكون فيها تعظيم لما تطلع ابن تيمية شديد جدا عم بقول لك يعني معناته الاوكيجن بالنسبه لهم انه اليوم ولد الرب هذا معناته فلما تيجي تقول له مبروك عليك ولاده الرب هذا شيء يعني خطير جدا اذا الانسان بيقصدها فاذا بيقصدها فيها كفر وعياذ بالله اكيد ما بيقصدها ما فيها
الانسان بيقصدها اكيد الانسان مش عايز يسعد الانسان
بايامه يعني ايه ما
بده يعني عشان يسعد الانسان بايامه
الحمد لله تعالى
يلا يلا اندت
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 thank you let's see you next
thank you
see you next presentation جزاك الله خيرا دكتور بارك الله فيك ان شاء الله تعالى
الله يحييك
ممكن نروح بقى